devils, ghosts, and goblins. Well, this is fantasy. We all know the murderer is sitting right here with us.
Planet without violence, where the inhabitants are as peaceful as sheep, the entity would be as a hungry wolf in that fold.
Howdy, folks. Welcome to the Spaghetti Theater for another Spaghetti Theater review. Can you guess what show I'm reviewing this time? Yeah, Star Trek. Yeah, for the first time. Get out of here, Spock. I'm going to review an episode of the original Star Trek. My favorite of all the Star Treks. See? I have all of them on glorious DVD. I know, these shitloaded DVDs. This is when they first released them on DVD. Each DVD has two episodes on it. It's about 80 episodes. Ish. And I know, there are a lot of great episodes of this particular series. And calling this one the best is simply my own opinion, I know. When you have other huge contenders like City on the Edge of Forever to compete with, which was also directed by the same guy. The first thing I like about this episode is the cool-ass writing by Robert Block. Then the fact that it's sort of a murder mystery whodunit at the same time. Sort of like a Perry Mason episode collided with Star Trek. And what I also love about this episode is that it's very Scotty-centric. It's something you would rarely see, where he gets into a wee bit of trouble, as he puts it many decades later. Scotty wouldn't get this much attention again until the next season with The Lights of Zatar. But screw that episode, because this one is far better. Sorry, Sherry Lewis, I liked you better as Lamb Chops anyway. So whisk all the way to the year 2267. Where the Enterprise has stopped off at this planet here called Argilius 2. An awesome-ass spaceport and rest stop. A planet known for its harmless, peace-loving people, as we see from this dancing lady in some sort of Argilian opium den. Where we find Captain Kirk, Dr. McCoy, and Scotty enjoying the show. And maybe doing some opium. Who the hell knows? They're not gonna show that, though. Cause they're all here to help Scotty. Since he seemingly resents women for some reason.
For example, his total resentment toward women. The explosion that threw Scotty against a bulkhead was caused by a woman.
And a recent head injury that he received happened to be caused by a woman, furthering his disgust towards them, I guess. He seems to like this chick.
Scotty, in Argilia they use the lights.
No one has to tell an old Aberdeen pup thrower how to applaud, Captain.
Yeah, Kirk. Let Scotty celebrate the female form any way he pleases. You womanizing spaceship lover, you. Yet, Captain Kirk was nice enough to invite this belly dancer over to their table so they could meet her. And so Scotty could get a closer look at something that he apparently resents. But again, he really seems to be enjoying this chick. Scotty even asked the lady to go for a walk with him. And she agrees to. Which Kirk says that he's cool with, but based on the way he mumbles out this answer, one might think differently.
We won't leave without this guy. Relax and enjoy yourself.
Have a good time, you fucking asshole.
Relax and enjoy yourself.
Hell was that? And while all this is happening, these two folks, No-Nose and Snake Charmer, take notice to Scotty and the belly dancer as they leave. Kirk and McCoy, too, since Kirk the man-whore has been to every nightclub on Argilius and wants to get McCoy laid, too, I guess. So they walk down the fog-ridden streets of Argilius. Damn, it's foggy out here. Almost like a machine was pumping it out from somewhere. When, hey, did Finnegan, Kirk's old college roommate, just walk by? Or did they just shop at the same store? But no time to get chased around by his wacky ass, because suddenly they hear a loud scream coming from a woman not far away. So they rush to the scene to see what the hell it is. When, the belly dancer has been killed. And is she dead, Jim?
She's dead, Chuck.
She is. And has apparently been repeatedly stabbed to death by Scotty! What the fuck? Scotty killed a bitch! Guess it was all that Argilian booze, you Scottish nutbag. So roll the intro! Outer space, the final frontier! Blah blah blah. Our 5-year mission is to be cut off after only 3 years because nobody could believe that humans hadn't evolved to letting women captain starships. By the year 2268, when even the Romulans had crossed that barrier. Idiots. Back on Argilius. We get to meet this guy. the chief investigator here on Argilius, overseeing Scotty's apparent killing. Yup, Scotty's a murderer, and this guy's name is Mr. Hengist, and he's not even from Argilius, as he points out.
My home planet, Rigel 4, I'd have a dozen investigators working on the matter.
He's from a planet called Rigel 4. Sounds like a Star Trek planet, because Argilius hires outside of their own planet when it comes to criminal officials. I get it.
Argilius hires its administrative officers from other planets.
That's what they said. It's their way. They're a peaceful people. They're not used to this kind of shit. And this guy here is character actor John Fielder. The year after this, he would go on to do what he's most famous for. The voice of Piglet on Winnie the Pooh. Plus the many TV and film roles that he did. Yep, this is Piglet. And if you listen, you can really hear it. It's basically his voice. Just like Sterling Holloway, the guy who did Winnie the Pooh. That's just how they sound. They don't try to change their voice at all.
The Argilians aren't very efficient, you know. Gentle harmless people. The Argilians aren't very efficient, you know. Gentle harmless people.
So Hengist here, Piglet, questions Scotty. Even shows him the hell out of the knife that he supposedly used to knife that belly dancer to death with. Only Scotty claims to have no memory of the killing and simply blacked it all out. And then simply came to once it was all over. How convenient, Scotty. That is a little weird. So he has amnesia! How convenient. Again.
I don't remember.
Temporary amnesia. Kirk and McCoy then argue about what to do. He does have that old head injury that could be to blame for that blackout part. Maybe. But still, they don't want to just not help Scotty and proove his innocence. But there's also the fact that they're on another planet under Argilian law. So it's really up to them and their court system to decide. So Scotty, execution time. I'm just kidding. They're peaceful folk, usually. But it isn't looking good for Scotty, though, since his prints were the only ones found on that knife. And he was found standing there, over the dead lady, at the scene of the crime, with the actual knife in his hand, so... Scotty, the hell? Yeah, he did it. Case closed, Scotty. You're fucked. Doing you a favor, Scotty, seriously. They're gonna throw you to the wolves anyway. Kirk then recalls the only suspects he could muster up. No nose and snake charmer guy. Yeah, look at this guy. He has no nose. Or at least he has like a flat nose. It's like somebody punched him right in the face. That's when this guy conveniently shows up. Not only an official of Argilius, but the main official. The head guy. They call him the prefect. His name's Jarvis, but they call him the prefect. That's like the president, I guess. And this guy's been on Star Trek before. He was in a first season episode called Return of the Archons, where he played the character of Landru. If you've ever seen that one. Star Trek fans, I'm sure you have. Maybe. And he suggests that everybody just come over to his house, because his wife has telepathic abilities. She's an empath, or an empath, however you say it. And he's confident that her magical powers will reveal the truth. That's when Piglet tries to exercise his authority.
Don't you think this should be handled in an official manner through my office?
Shut up, Piglet. Nobody likes you. I like the actor John Fielder. He's just playing such a good dickhead here that it's easy to hate him. Great job, John Fielder. Way to knock it out of the park. So, whoop, we're at the prefect's house for answers. Wow, what an honor. The prefect's house. It's like visiting the White House, where Kirk offers his assistance with their medical team. When Piglet blurts in again with his 2 cents.
Oh, I'd advise against it, Prefect. This is purely an Argilian matter.
This guy, he thinks the Prefect should turn down outside help. But you're outside help too, Piglet. Mister, I'm from Rigel 4.
My home planet, Rigel 4.
Shithead. So thankfully they all agree with me and they tell Piglet to go shove it pretty much.
My wife must meditate for a time before she's ready. I see no reason why we should not use that time to good advantage.
Go gather up the usual suspects. Do something useful for this telepathic seance we're about to have. You baldy-headed bastard, you. So Kirk has Spock beam this lady down from sickbay to examine Scotty the murderer, who Piglet takes notice of before leaving. Don't smile at me, you weirdo. So then they send Scotty off alone with this lady into a secluded room, since apparently the examination requires silence, I guess. However stupid it is, to let a possible murderer killer be locked alone in a room with a woman, a defenseless woman, but okay. She's not wearing a red shirt, so so I'm sure she'll be fine. No, but clearly, we know Scotty's not a killer, right? He's a crazy bastard sometimes. Bit of an alcoholic, but he's not a killer. Unless that bump on the head thing turns him into Jekyll and Hyde. Or maybe guilt itself blocked it out. So many theories. Who the hell knows? That's what we're trying to find out. I love this fucking thing. So enter the prefect's hot trophy wife, Sibo, the empath who plans on using her telepathic abilities to locate this killer. That's why everyone involved must be present for this seance. I'm gonna call it a seance, I hope that's okay. But first she needs that murder weapon so she can commune with it and shit. Only, it's gone! Someone took it! Great, really? Just leave the murder weapon lying the fuck around? What kind of investigation is it? CSI would fucking not do this shit. So of course they all immediately hear a woman scream. I wonder who the hell that could be. And they all run to that room where they lock Scotty up and yep, what do you know? Scotty has killed again and has passed out in his chair. Exhausting it is, murdering people. And when he wakes up, he once again has total amnesia, at least when it comes to the events of the actual killing. Blacked it all out again. And once again, all the evidence clearly points to Scotty. What the fuck are you doing, Scotty? There was no other way into that room. You're a murderer, Scotty. Fuck is wrong with you? One minute you're crawling around Jeffrey's tubes, next minute you're Ted fucking Bundy. Shithead. That's when Piglet returns with his two suspects, No Nose and Snake Charmer, when he gets to find out about the recent murder.
There's been another murder, Haggis.
That's terrible. How was the girl killed?
Now, did he just assume that the victim was female? Because no one told him. What you hiding, Rigel Four Piglet, shithead? Columbo would have cracked this thing by now. So it turns out this Snake Charmer guy was actually the father of that belly dancer who was murdered.
She was my daughter.
And wants sweet ass revenge for this shit. And No Nose here is a guy named Morla. Nice name, No Nose, Morla. Him and the dancer were supposedly in love. Only he had a very jealous nature when it came to her belly dancing lifestyle, causing them to feud all the time. That's why he stormed the hell out of there at the beginning. He's just an idiot. So this is all going nowhere as McCoy returns from investigating that crime scene, and Kirk's getting all frustrated and stressed out.
Well, get on with it, man. Just don't stand there.
You're the captain. Calm down. This trying to help Scotty thing is really pushing him over the edge. So let's get to this telepath thing already. And to make sure everything goes smoothly, the prefect locks everybody in. Way to go. Peace, love, and planet, but you have a button that does that. Nice. James Bond villain shit. Kirk makes a quick call to Spock to get his opinion on using this empath shit to verify Scotty's innocence. And his analysis, it's a real thing, but not something you would want to risk a man's life on. But hey, you don't really have a choice. This guy Jarrus, the prefect, actually seems like a reasonable guy though. He even ignores Piglet most of the time. Doesn't even seem to like him. Understandable. He's a weasel. Spock suggests that they all just beam aboard the Enterprise and let the ship's computer's lie detector get to the bottom of all this shit. But that's gonna have to wait because it's seance time. Cebu's gonna bring out the evil. And she finds it all right pretty quick and starts going on and on about it too.
Hatred of women.
It hates women. Well, yeah, that much is clear. That we know. It's not very fond of women. It's a hunger that never dies.
A hunger that never dies. Overpowering, an ancient terror.
Sounds interesting, actually. She even starts calling it by name.
It has a name. Baradis Kessler. Reja.
When, boom, boom! The lights go out and Cebu screams aloud. Then, when the lights come back on, great. Scotty has once again killed. He stabbed this poor woman dead. Scotty, no denying that shit now. Right there in front of us, Scotty. What were you thinking? She was trying to help your ass. That's probably why you killed her. So cut to later where they put Scotty into some sort of timeout again. Even though he is suspected of killing three women. No cuffs, no cell, nothing. Just sit on the couch, Scotty. Bad boy. Think about what you did. Okay? They were all there this time, yet Scotty still cries innocence, and Piglet is still being an unhelpful dick.
By your own admission, you don't know whether you did or didn't. So-called failing memory.
Shut up, Piglet. Why did they hire this guy? He sucks.
You may have killed without knowing it.
so Scotty could have killed without knowing it. So now that all else has seemingly failed, Kirk suggests they all beam aboard the Enterprise and do what Spock said about putting Scotty on the computer's lie detector. And Kirk insists this will work.
No doubt will remain.
There'll be no doubt after this. And, being a reasonable guy again, the Prefect agrees.
We will go to your ship.
But does deserve the right to make the final decision in the end. Which means, if Scotty's guilty, he'll be sentenced to death by slow torture! Yeah.
The ancient penalty for murder was death by slow torture.
Torture!
That law has never been changed.
A peaceful planet, yes. Only these old laws from another time are still on the books. Might want to work on that, guys. Torture! So, we're aboard the Enterprise! Yeah!
Each testifier will sit here, place his hand on this plate. Any deviation from the factual truth will be immediately detected and relayed to this computer.
As Kirk explains how the lie detector works here, in the Enterprise's People's Court. And the Prefect, still being an awesome-ass guy, is down with all of this. You go, Landrew. Way to not stir up the shit pot. So, Scotty takes the stand, which the computer immediately recognizes.
Lieutenant Commander Montgomery Scott.
And even claims he doesn't have amnesia.
Sufficient abnormalities to account for periods of functional amnesia.
Negative.
But isn't lying about having no memory of the killings. So, that's odd.
Unless Scotty's lying about his loss of memory.
I'm not lying, Captain.
Computer, accuracy scan.
Subject relaying accurate about.
So that's when Scotty waits until now to mention that he didn't pass out when Sebo was killed, the Prefect's wife. He was awake for all that shit. He even tried to move over and help Sebo, only some thing was in his way that he describes as
cold. It was like a stinking draft out of a slaughterhouse.
Yeah, that.
It wasn't really there.
So something not of this world, something not human. And as crazy as it sounds, the computer claims he's telling the truth.
Subject remains accurate account. No physiological changes.
So take that, piglet! Fucker. The computer says he didn't kill Sebo when Piglet chimes in again.
You killed Sebo?
No, Captain.
He's been saying that right along. It's no more now than it did before.
Piglet, I swear you're on thin ice. Keep your mouth shut, you negative Nancy. It's almost like you want to see Scotty hang for this. So Kirk has Scotty lie to proove the computer knows all.
How old are you? 22, sir.
Inaccurate. Data in error.
There, Piglet, you asshole. Satisfied? Now sit down and shut up. Even though after all this, Scotty is still the most likely suspect, I just want to see Piglet fail at this point.
This is a waste of time.
A waste of time, Piglet? What do you know? No one's listening to you anyway. So apparently, Piglet won't be satisfied until he's convinced the computer is incapable of being wrong. Even though he's against all of this in the first place.
I object to the entire procedure.
No one cares what you object to, Piglet. Now shut the fuck up.
If you can convince me that the machine is incapable of error, and if it shows he did not kill the women.
There will be no error.
And again, the Prefect also ignores Piglet and lets Kirk do his thing. Way to go, I love that Prefect.
For the time being, we will accept Captain Kirk's explanation of the machine's accuracy as factual. I do, however, reserve to myself the right to make the final determination.
As long as he still gets the final say, we know, Prefect, you've earned this shit. You can do whatever you want, Prefect. You have been so cool about this, Jarvis. So No-Nose takes the stand and he swears all he's guilty of is over-loving his woman, that belly dancer. Then her dad, Snake Charmer, chimes in.
That's not true!
Claiming that's a bunch of shit. And the two of them fought all the time, because of his jealousy.
All the time.
Yet the computer claims he's telling the truth when he says he didn't kill anyone. So you're free to go, No-Nose, get the hell out of here. Go buy a new nose. Kirk then brings up all that rambling that Sebo was doing before she was killed.
Varadis Kessler, Reja.
Assuming that she was right, which the Prefect swears she is.
My poor Sebo's talent was genuine, gentlemen.
He is such a cool and calm guy, taking all this so well. He's being so fair with Scotty, even though it looks like he clearly murdered his wife. think he'd want to jump over the table and strangle him. But no, he's playing this fair. And McCoy even somehow remembers all the names that she said in that same rambling.
Baradis, Kessler, Regic.
Regic, Baradis, Kessler.
Damn, McCoy. No wonder you're a doctor. That's a good memory. I barely remembered her name in this guy's.
Kessler.
So they asked the always reliable computer what these names mean. And it shoots back with a pretty shocking answer.
Six names, format, murderer of women, other Earth synonym, Jack the Ripper.
It was a nickname given to Jack the Ripper.
Jack the Ripper.
Well, that's ridiculous. He lived hundreds of years ago.
Yeah, that Jack the Ripper. Only in space! How can that even be? As they all immediately question. He's been dead for centuries, Jack the Ripper.
A man couldn't survive all these centuries.
I point out that Jack the Ripper slew at will in the heart of the most populous city of Old Earth and was never identified.
He was never caught, that's true. The prefect then points out that his wife Sibo said it was a hunger that never dies.
It is a hunger that never dies.
Interesting. All this points to Jack the Ripper, they've decided. Meaning that Jack the Ripper was never really a man as we know it.
Jack the Ripper couldn't be alive if he were a man.
He may have been some sort of entity. Which they slowly discover to be true as they gather more information from the computer. And in the world of Star Trek, things like entities made out of pure energy, that's nothing new. They're used to this kind of shit. It's not impossible.
Sibo said that it feeds on death, not just death, but fear.
It feeds on death and fear. And of course, Piglet thinks all this is ridiculous.
Surely, Prefect, this has gone far enough. Some man has killed three women. Are we gonna let him go and start chasing ghosts?
Please, Piglet, this is Star Trek. They can do what they want. Time travel exists. And to prove all this further, they ask the computer if there's evidence to prove that a creature like this exists. And yep, there is, all right. They find all sorts of cases where women were mass murdered on Earth in similar ways of Jack the Ripper. A trail of murders that eventually, over time, leads out into space on other planets that all eventually line up with Earth and Argilius. Weird. We're gonna find this guy. Space Columbo would have figured this out quicker. So Jack the Ripper was an alien entity who couldn't die. He was just some pure energy that took over the body of some random guy, started murdering people, and then would just move from body to body over the course of time. Eventually journeyed into space. That's some fascinating shit, but not to Piglet, of course.
Fairy tales, ghosts, and goblins.
Fairy tales. Like Winnie the Pooh, you would say that, Piglet. And yes, fairy tales can be real on Star Trek, you idiot. Just go to that shore leaf planet and you'll see. Or even that cat's paw planet, if you're still alive another day. Many examples, Piglet, many. Remember Trelane? He could do whatever the hell he wanted. So Piglet seems to want to stop them from calling this creature up. This is getting a little weird, Piglet. That's when they go on to find out that another one of those nicknames given to the mass murderer of women happened on a little planet called Rigel 4. Apparently a lot of killings happened on that planet recently.
Murders on Rigel 4 occurred one solar year ago.
And who in this room is from Rigel 4? Oh, that's right, you Piglet.
My home planet, Rigel 4.
Mr. Hengist. Whatever. So now they want him to take the stand. Take that, Piglet. Which he refuses to do, of course.
Why will not?
Mr. Hengist.
Spock then even points out he's even the perfect suspect. Which is when he says,
an entity which feeds on fear and terror would find a perfect hunting ground on Argilius. The entity would be as a hungry wolf in that fold.
That's the title of the episode. What a treat. And to further incriminate Piglet, they find out through the computer that knife that was used to murder the three women was made on, yep, good old Rigel 4 again, the home planet of Piglet.
Fairy tales, ghosts, and goblins.
Artifacts produced by hill people of Argus River region, planet Rigel 4.
Jack the Ripper, you pile of shit! We got you! Hundreds of years later, but we got you! So boom! He panics and transforms into a stuntman, wearing a ball cap, starts fighting everybody, action figure! So Kirk punches him in the face so hard that... He's dead, Jim?
He's dead, Jack.
Yup, he's dead, Jim, from Kirk's punch.
Well, that's impossible.
Nope, the entity of Jack the Ripper simply fled the body of Piglet and is now inside the ship's computer. So it's in control of the Enterprise now. Shit, see, it looks like that. Psychedelic, man. So instead of just destroying the Enterprise, the entity wants to breed fear and terror, because it feeds on that. Kirk then comes up with the idea of drugging the whole crew, so they're in a relaxed enough state to not be afraid or in terror. So time to get wasted, everybody. We then get to see inside the Enterprise computer, which looks like it's about as high tech as an 80s arcade machine. That's when this lady shows up to drug everyone, especially Sulu. We know how easily swindled to the other side he is. So sit down, Sulu, you nuts. Kirk and Spock then come up with a genius plan to overwork the computer by asking it to resolve the value of pi, an equation that goes on forever and ever and has no resolution. But the computer will keep trying to figure it out until all else fails. End of time!
Compute to the last digit the value of pi.
So back in that courtroom, where nearly everyone has been drugged now, as the entity flees the computer.
Complete computer control, Captain. The entity has fled.
And they regain control of the Enterprise. Yeah! Only if Jack the Ripper's out of the computer now, where the hell will he go? According to McCoy, if he was to enter a drugged body, the worst he could do is take up knitting. I would love to see that Jack the Ripper knitting, or Piglet knitting. So Kirk has McCoy drug everyone who hasn't been drugged yet, including himself, leaving only Kirk and Spock as the only sober ones. Can you imagine a drugged Spock? Again? Good move, Kirk. So they go to drug Prefect Jarvis when, boom bum, he's Jack the Ripper now.
Oh no, kill you all, die, make you suffer.
But not for long, cause Vulcan neck pinch. He then flees back into Piglet's body and takes a hostage. Only everybody's drugged up and they think it's a big joke. I love McCoy here.
Be careful, don't hurt somebody with it.
So fucking hilarious, McCoy. This allows them to knock down Piglet and drug his ass too. So Kirk can quickly carry him to the transporter over his shoulder, where Spock's forced to shove this idiot out of the way and beam Piglet out into open space. Take that, Piglet. Where he will eventually die. Hopefully. I guess. Good riddance, he was a dick anyway.
Kill you all.
Jack the Ripper. You asshole, you. Then the guy Spock shove is all butthurt about being pushed around.
Didn't have to shove me, Mr. Spock. I'd have gotten around to it.
Really, Mr. Kyle, or whoever the hell you are? Would you have now? Not fast enough, goofball. Well, that craziness is over, and the entire ship is drugged and happy.
Well, Mr. Spock, for the next 5 or 6 hours, we're going to have the happiest crew in space.
The happiest crew in space. Sounds like a Disney movie. So with Spock being the only other sober one, Kirk's plans of relaxing on Argilius are shot. Unless he wants to go bar hopping with Mr. Spock. Yeah, not really his thing. I would love to see a whole episode based on that. So fuck that, I guess. Kirk needs a drinking buddy. What about Prefect Jarvis? He never got drugged, and seems like a hell of a nice guy. Cool as shit. Oh well, leave this drugged idiot to the transporter room, cause we're out of here. The episode is over, and Jack the Ripper is finally dead. Maybe, we hope. May you rest in peace, Belly Dancer, Lieutenant Tracy, and SIBO. You will be the last victims of a very famous serial killer. Which leads me into my final thoughts of my favorite episode of Star Trek, the original series. It is hard to pick a favorite. I have a ton. I love the idea that Jack the Ripper was an entity this whole time that couldn't die and move from body to body. It was like that movie Fallen with Denzel Washington. An underrated classic now. An interesting fact I learned about James Doohan, or Doohan, who plays Scotty, is that they would hide his right hand in all the shots because he's missing his middle finger. Because of an injury he got during the D-Day invasion of Normandy, 1944. Wow, Scotty was at Normandy. Way to go, Scotty! Way to fight the Nazis! Another cool fact about this episode, it's the first time we get to hear Scotty's first name, Montgomery. It's the first time it's ever mentioned. And another neat fact, even though four people died in this episode, none of them wore red shirts. Isn't that weird? And this episode didn't feature very much Spock, did it? Even though he was very popular. Something I read was that Shatner was getting jealous of Spock's popularity and wanted a little more screen time, so they gave him more screen time in this episode. I don't know how true that is, though. You jealous bastard, Shatner. You're the captain, you got plenty of screen time. Some of the other actors in this episode, like this guy, No-Nose, he's Charles Dierkop, a character actor who is still alive to this day. And this guy, Snake Charmer. I remember him from that Twilight Zone episode, The Shelter, the one with Jack Albertson, Grandpa Joe. They're all fighting to get in that one guy's shelter, the Twilight Zone episode. Here's another weird fact. Lieutenant Tracy, Jack the Ripper's second victim in this episode, this lady, wrote four episodes of the Beauty and the Beast TV series. Final thing I want to mention is the writer of this episode, Robert Block. He wrote this episode and two others, What Are Little Girls Made Of and Cat's Paw. He also wrote the book Psycho that the movie was based on. Well, that will do it for my look at Star Trek's Season 2, Episode 14, Wolf in the Fold. Where it may have taken a few hundred years, but thanks to computers and technology, we finally brought Jack the Ripper to justice. Way to go, science! So thanks for watching. To all my subscribers and comment leavers, thank you again, and I'll see you at the theater.